Hello everyone, welcome back to my channel AeroHub and welcome to the series of lectures in aerospace structures. In the last lecture we discussed how to find out the bending stress of a wing section as well as fuselage section, and from this lecture we will start out one of the important concept in airframe design or airframe analysis, that is the shear flow of airframe sections. And we will discuss how to analyze the shear flow of idealized open and closed section, which is applicable for both airframe as well as marine structures. Now you can see we have a C section or a channel section, and this section is idealized. You can see the dimensions. The height of the web is 25 centimeter and the length of the flange is 10 centimeter, and we have four boom areas, 1, 2, 3, and 4, and each boom area is equal to 3 cm², and it is subjected to a vertical load of 5000 newton. Okay, now the question is we have to find out the shear flow distribution as well as the location of shear center. Okay, so the first step is always to find out the value of moment of inertia for a section. So we are aware, since we are applying the load in the vertical direction, we have to find out the value of IHx, that is equal to n into a y square. Okay, we have discussed how this formula is coming, like we have bdq by 12 plus a y square, and the BDQ by 12 factor is neglected because we have a idealized section here. That's why we have AY square. N is nothing but the number of boom areas. A is the area of the corresponding boom, and Y is the distance of the boom area from the centroidal axis or the neutral axis. Since the section is symmetric about the horizontal axis, we have the value of Y as 25 divided by 2, that will be 12.5, and we have 4 boom areas. 4 into the area of each boom is 3 cm² into 12.5, that is 25 divided by 2, and this gives the moment of inertia of the section, and the value will be equal to 1875 cm⁴. This is the moment of inertia I of the section. Okay, now to find out the value of shear flow for an idealized section, we have several methods. So we will discuss two methods. So we will discuss today method number one, that is the method of cut. Okay, so for method of cut, we have to consider two section. We have a channel section here. We have to consider two sections at a unit distance. Okay, we are arranging two C sections or a channel section at a unit distance of 1. Okay, now we have to find out the value of bending stress acting on the section. So we have the formula, sigma is equal to M into Y divided by I. Okay, we know the value of Y, that is nothing but the distance from neutral axis, that will be equal to 25 divided by 2, that will be 12.5. we have the value of moment of inertia, and we have to find out the value of M. Okay, M is nothing but, we have the vertical load, that is I can write as V, that is a shear load, vertical load into the distance, moment arm. So I'll apply the vertical load somewhere here. Okay, and the moment arm will be 1 cm into Y divided by I. Okay, so finally I'll be getting the value of V here is 5000 newton. So 5000 into 1 into Y is nothing but 12.5, and the value of moment of inertia is 1875 cm⁴. So finally I'll be getting the value of sigma, that is a bending stress acting on each and every boom. You have to understand that when you idealize a section, the boom areas will be carrying the bending stress or direct stress, and the skin will be carrying the shear stress. Okay, so the boom areas, this boom areas will carry the bending stress, and the skin will be carrying the shear stress or shear flow. Okay, so when you solve this for bending stress, I'll be getting 33.33 newton per centimeter square. This is the value for bending stress sigma. Okay, now what you have to do is we have to find out the load acting on the corresponding boom areas. That is, we have to find out the value of load P1, P2, P3, P4. And these are nothing but the boom areas of the corresponding areas. Okay, for example, we have boom area 1, boom area 2, boom area 3 and boom area 4 arranged here. We have to find out the load acting on this particular boom area. So, to find out the load acting on the boom areas, what we have to do is, you are aware about the formula sigma is equal to P divided by A. That's nothing but sigma is equal to load by area. We have the value of sigma and we have the value of area. Since the area is same for the entire boom areas, we will be getting the same value of load for each and every boom area. So P1 is equal to P2 is equal to P3 is equal to P4. That will be equal to sigma into A. So sigma is 33.33, the area is 3. So I'll be getting 99.99, so I'll write as 100 newton. Okay, these are the load acting on the corresponding boom areas. Okay, so the first step is you have to find out the moment of inertia, then we'll find out the bending moment in such a way that we will consider two sections at a unit distance apart. Then we'll find out the bending stress. Then we'll find out the load acting on each and every boom area. Okay, now what we'll do is we will apply compressive load on first two boom areas and we'll apply tensile load on the other two boom areas. That is, when you have an axis of symmetry, I will apply compressive load of 100 newton, because we have 100 newton load on these two areas. Okay, we have compressive load on boom area 1 and boom area 2, and we will apply tensile load on boom area 3 and boom area 4. Okay, so we will apply compressive load on boom area 1 and 2, which is above the neutral axis, and we will apply tensile load below the neutral axis. Okay, now to find out the value of shear flow, we are using the method of cut. That is, we will cut the section to find out the shear flow for portion 1, 2. We will analyze each and every portion simultaneously, then we'll find out the shear flow. For example, first we'll find out the shear flow distribution for portion 1, 2, that is its upper flange. Therefore, we have to provide a cut on portion 1, 2, then we have to analyze. Okay, then you have to aware about one important notation. That is, if you have a 2D element, something like this, to make the 2D element in equilibrium under shear load, this is the shear load acting here. Okay, so this is the head of the shear notation. These two should meet. That is, head should meet, and here you should be tail should meet. Okay, simultaneously I'll be having head meeting here. Okay, that is, heads meet and tails meet. This is the condition for equilibrium for shear loads. Okay, heads meet here and tails meet here. Simultaneously we have to use this technique to find out the value of shear flow. Okay, now listen here, we have this section again. I have this channel section again, and I have the boom areas 1, 2, 3, 4, and I am applying a compressive load on boom area 1 and boom area 2, and I am applying a tensile load on boom area 3 and boom area 4. Okay, this is a complete section. Okay, a C section which is separated by a unit distance, that is two C sections separated by a unit distance. Now, to find out the shear flow for portion 1, 2, this is portion 1, 2 upper flange, we have to provide the cut on portion 1, 2. So I will apply 100 newton on the upper on compressive stress on portion 1, 2 and tensile for portion 3 and 4, that is the boom areas 3 and 4. When you made a cut, I can see this one is the section 1 and this one become section 2. Okay, so this is a separate section here, section 1 and section 2. Okay, I have a 100 newton load acting in the compressive zone for section 1. So to make the section in equilibrium, when you have a change in bending moment, we have to apply a shear load. The rate of change of bending moment is always the shear force. So I have to apply a shear force. This is coming, it's compressive, so I will go for a tensile. Okay, so to make this section 1 in equilibrium, I have to apply a shear load of same magnitude in the tensile region. Okay, so this is, so the equilibrium condition is satisfied for section 1. Now, if I consider section 2, I have 100 newton acting in the compression and I have 200 newton acting in tensile. So the resultant force will be 100 newton acting in the tensile, that is in this direction towards inside. Okay, to make this section 2 in equilibrium, I have to apply a shear load outwards. So this will be the shear load outward acting in such a way that the section 2 will be equilibrium here. Okay, so section 1 is in equilibrium since we have a 100 newton acting in compressive region. So I'll apply a shear load in towards inside to make that in equilibrium. Now, to find out the value of shear flow, I'll suggest the direction of shear flow in such a way that here the head should meet and here the tail should meet. Okay, these two conditions should be satisfied. Okay, this is the direction of shear flow which satisfies these two conditions. You can see I made a shear distribution in such a way that these two tails are meeting. Okay, similarly I am making a shear distribution in such a way that this shear and this shear is meeting, that is the head is meeting, here the tail is meeting, so this will be in equilibrium. So the value of these forces will be 100 newton, so the value of shear flow will be 100 newton per centimeter, not millimeter, 100 newton per centimeter. See, we have a load of 100 newton on section 1, so to make this in equilibrium, we are applying the same amount of load. Similarly, for section 2, we have a resultant force of 100 newton acting towards inside. Okay, so to make the section 2 in equilibrium, we are providing a shear load of 100 newton outside. Okay, so this will act on this edges, that is this portion 1, 2, and that will be 100 newton per centimeter. So the direction will be from left to right, 100 newton per centimeter, that is a constant shear flow. Okay, so we have done with the portion 1, 2, that is the upper flange. Now we are going for the middle web. As in case A, we have to apply the compressive load of 100 newton on portion 1-2 and tensile load on portion 3-4. Okay, oh, so this will be your section 1 and this will be the section 2. Okay, now you can see that for section 1 and section 2 we have same amount of load is acting. For section 1 we have 100 newton, 200 plus 100 we have 200 newton, and section 2 also we have 200 newton load. To section 1 we have a 100 newton acting towards us, that is a compressive load, so we have to apply a tensile load of 200 newton. This should be 200 newton of tensile load of 200 newton to make the particular section 1 in equilibrium. Similarly, for section 2 we have a 200 newton load acting in the tensile direction, so we will apply a complementary shear load in compressive direction, that is towards outside, of magnitude 200 newton. Okay, so here we have tails meet and here we have heads meet, so it will be coming here. Tails is meeting here, tail is meeting here, the head is meeting, so this condition is satisfied. So we have for portion 2-3 we have a shear flow of 200 newton per centimeter from bottom to top. Okay, 200 newton per centimeter from bottom to top. Okay, similarly for the lower flange I am applying the compressive load of 100 newton for portion 1-2 and I am applying a tensile load of 100 newton for portion 3 and 4. Okay, so for we are making a cut on the lower flange. Here we have a 100 newton, this is portion 1 and this is portion 2. For portion 2 we have a 100 newton acting in the tensile region, so I will apply a compressive load of 100 newton here, 100 newton, and this will be same magnitude of 100. And for portion 1 I have 200 newton acting in the compressive section and I have 100 newton acting in the tensile section, so the resultant load is a 100 newton that will be acting in the compressive region, so I have to apply a load in the tensile region, so that will be in this direction. Okay, I have to apply a 100 newton in this, that is for 100 newton. Okay, so it will be in equilibrium and here tail is meeting, here head is meeting, so this will be the direction of shear flow. Okay, so finally I will be getting, and the magnitude is 100 newton per centimeter. This is 100 newton per centimeter. Okay, so this is the shear flow distribution for the channel section. One, two, three, four. So I have shear flow in this direction, that is 100 newton per centimeter, and here it will be in this direction, that is 200 newton per centimeter. And on 3-4 we have from 100 newton per centimeter. Okay, so that is the shear flow distribution, and this shear flow distribution is called active shear flow, active shear flow distribution. Okay, now to find out the value of shear center we have to consider the reactive shear flow, that is we are applying the shear load in vertical direction, that is in this direction, 5000 newton. Okay, now we are applying the shear load in vertical plus y direction. Okay, vertically upwards. So when the section is subjected to this amount of load, there will be certain amount of reaction. So the reactive shear flow is nothing but the direction of shear flow will be reversed. Okay, instead of from left, that is from a clockwise direction, we will draw the shear flow pattern in the anti-clockwise direction. Okay, that is, we have the section here, 1, 2, 3, 4, and we have active shear flow from in a clockwise direction, is clockwise, so I will draw in an anti-clockwise direction. It will be in this direction. The magnitude of shear flow will be the same, only the direction is changing. And this will be 100 newton per centimeter. Okay, we are applying a shear load of 5000 newton at a distance E from the web, vertical web. Okay, now we have to find out the value of shear center, and you are aware that the shear load, we have to understand that the shear load of the applied shear load should withstand the moment produced by the shear force of the section. Okay, so you have to understand, we have the same magnitude of shear force acting on the web. Okay, similar to the unidealized section, we analyzed the unidealized section and we have found out that the shear flow distribution is something like this. We have maximum shear flow at the center of the web and we got the shear flow pattern something like this for an unidealized shear C section. Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4, and we found out that the maximum shear flow will be at the center of the web. Okay, but in this case, for an idealized section, we have the there is no maximum shear flow at all. Okay, for each and every section, the shear flow is always a constant. Okay, that is, due to the presence of the boom, the shear flow become constant between the booms. Okay, between point 1 and 2, the shear flow is constant. Between point 2 and 3, the shear flow is constant. Between 3 and 4, we have a constant shear flow. Okay, but when you don't have the boom areas, the shear flow is not a constant. It is always varying. Okay, we have at point 1 and point 4, we have zero shear flow. At point 5, we have the maximum shear flow. But this condition is not satisfied when we have a boom areas. That is, the calculation becomes really simpler when you have the presence of boom. Okay, and in this analysis we found out that the magnitude of shear force acting on the web is equal to the applied shear load. Okay, and so you can see here also the applied shear load is 2000, the shear flow is 200 newton per centimeter, the height of the web is 25 centimeter here. So the shear force acting on portion 2, 3, that is 200 newton per centimeter into 25 centimeter. Okay, so you'll be getting 200 newton by centimeter into 25 centimeter, that will be equal to 5000 newton. okay, so you are getting the same amount of shear force acting on the web for this section also. That is the idealized section also getting the same amount of shear force on the web. Okay, so to find out the value of shear center, we have to understand that, you have to understand that the moment produced by the flanges should counteract the moment produced by the web. Okay, we will be having equal amount of shear force acting on both upper flange and lower flange. So the shear force acting on 1, 2 will be equal to the shear force acting on 3, 4. You can see from the shear flow distribution for the idealized section. And in this case also we will be having same amount of shear force, because the shear flow diagram is same for upper flange and lower flange. The area under this diagram gives the shear force for the section. Okay. Now to find out the shear center, this distance E, that is 5000 into E, should be equal to the moment produced by the web should be equal to the moment produced by the upper and lower flange. Okay, the moment produced by the web should be equal to the moment produced by the upper and lower flange. And if you introduce the vertical load at a certain distance in such a way that, we have to introduce the vertical load in such a way that the moment produced by the applied shear load will be equal to the moment produced by the upper and lower flanges, and this will avoid the rotation of the section. What is shear center? It is a unique point in the cross section. When we are applying a shear load, the section will be subjected only in bending, there is no twisting. Okay, so when we have to introduce the shear load in such a way that the moment produced by the applied shear load should be equal to the moment produced by the flanges. So the moment produced by flanges is 100 into, this distance is 10 centimeter, I think, or 10 centimeter, 100 into 10, that gives the shear force acting on the upper flange into the moment arm is 25. Okay, so finally E will be 100 into 10 into 25 divided by 5000, and you will be getting 5 centimeter as the value of E. Okay, and you can ask one question, like we have a shear flow of a distribution is parabolic for the web of an unidealized section. Okay, so we have a constant shear flow for the idealized section. Okay, what happens here means when the section is getting idealized, the average shear flow is distributed for the idealized section. The average shear flow of the parabolic pattern will be distributed for the idealized section. That will make the calculation very simpler. Okay, that's why we are using idealized section methods for the airframe analysis. Okay, thank you so much for listening. Take care.